lecture series. Today's topic is going to be a time of contradictions, prohibition when Montana went dry. Prohibition failed in numerous ways, but obviously in the illegal activities it fostered. From 1918 to 1933, it failed especially in Montana, where organized crime, prostitution, bootlegging, and gambling involved some very plucky women. The Montana historical interpretive historian, Ellen Baumler, looks at some characters and their illegal activities. A little bit about Ellen. She has been an author, educator, and interpretive historian at the Montana Historical Society since 1992. She has composed hundreds of signs for Montana's historical sites, developed historic walking tours, written National Register nominations, and collaborated on the creation of roadside historical markers. She is a longtime teacher of Montana history, a member of the Humanities Montana Speakers Bureau, an award-winning author, hostess of the popular radio show History on the Go, and a 2011 recipient of the Governor's Award for the Humanities. Her current projects include a 150th commemorative history of Helena in partnership with the Helena Chamber and a new collection stories about haunted Helena. Both will be available sometime this year. At this time, will you help me welcome Ellen Baumler?
Thank you, Julie. Good evening, afternoon, I guess it's afternoon. So I don't have a watch and that clock is obviously wrong, so if you would, somebody tell me when I'm about five till so that we can have time for questions. So Prohibition failed probably, it failed miserably, but probably nowhere more miserably than it failed in Montana. And its outcomes actually were largely unforeseen. So I'm going to tell you about a few incidents leading up to Prohibition to sort of set the scene in Montana, which was, of course, a dry state. It went dry in January 1st, 1919, a year before the federal prohibition took effect. So there are a few women who were pretty colorful characters during this period. I'm going to tell you about some of those. But first we have to go back to the 19th century. This flyer is from maybe 1870s or so. And the Women's Christian Temperance Union actually formed in Montana. And here in Helena, it formed at Ming's Opera House in 1883. And it went really pretty strong at the beginning, and then it sort of petered out. Then in 1886, when Thomas Cruise married Margaret Carter, if you know anything about that wedding, it was a very elaborate, beautiful wedding. And in celebration, Thomas Cruise agreed to pay all the bar bills all over Helena, and it amounted to something like $30,000, which back then was a lot of money. And there were a lot of very drunk husbands. And so the WCTU reactivated because of that wedding, and it remained strong into the 1930s. So thanks to Thomas Cruise, we had a pretty good chapter of the WCTU, and a lot of very strong women were members of that. Now, there was a problem because, you know, they sort of went by what the Bible said, and in the book of Timothy, there is a statement that says, use a little wine for the stomach's sake. Well, these women had a really hard time reconciling that, and so they believed that alcohol was poison and drinking it was a sin, okay? So in order to sort of reconcile what the Bible said, they insisted that the Bible was actually advising people to rub alcohol on their abdomens. And, you know, towards the, into the early 1900s, there were reformers that came to visit Montana. A famous one was William Biederwolf, who came to Butte in 1905, and he preached a sermon. He was an evangelist and preached a sermon in the red light district in one of the dives there. And the women stopped what they were doing. They were very polite and listened to everything he said. And what he told them was, Butte is a stench in the nostrils of all good men and women. He said, you know, I thought I went to the gates of hell when I went to Tacoma. But he said, I'm sure I came to hell itself when I came to Butte. And of course, there was also Carrie Nation. And I have to say that my great-grandmother smashed bars with Carrie Nation in Kansas for a while. But she came to Montana also in about 1910, and she visited Butte, she visited Helena, and she visited Kalispell and other places. She made quite a sweep. She made no converts in Butte or anywhere in Montana for that matter, but when she visited Anaconda, all of the saloons sported signs that said, all nations welcome except Carrie. And when she came to Butte, of course, she talked with the ladies of the red light district, and they listened politely to her. Most of them spoke foreign languages and really didn't understand what she was saying anyway. And she made no converts there, and when she came to Helena, no one attended her lecture. And when she went to Kalispell, she got into a big fight in public on the streets with saloon keeper August Heller, and they called each other names and things. And anyway, she had quite a visit to Montana, but she never made any converts here and died the next year, which is why I think Butte likes to insist that the last saloon Carrie Nation visited was in Butte. It wasn't really, but they like to say that anyway. So Prohibition never would have passed without the vote of women. And so Prohibition was tied into the women's suffrage issue. Not only was suffrage a long campaign, but so was Prohibition. And it wasn't just women who favored, you know, a dry country. And there were signs on porches everywhere, wet or dry or wet or dry. It just depended on the neighborhood and probably who was living there. But it was really the women's voice that sort of clinched it here in Montana. And of course, women did get the vote in 1914. Jeanette Rankin, just to say a few words about that election in 1916, when Montana elected three women. Unfortunately, Jeanette Rankin's win eclipsed the really important fact that the first women were also elected to the Montana legislature. And it's those two women, and not really Jeanette Rankin, that, you know, did a lot of work. Many viewed Rankin's actions as treason when she voted against World War I and again against World War II. We had troops that were already committed overseas at that point, and a lot of people, you know, really didn't care for that. So I just want to talk for a few moments about these two women who are really very, very important, I think, to Montana history. They took their seats in the legislature in 1917 and really helped lay the cornerstones of our modern welfare system. They both made huge contributions to Montana, but they also had interesting personal lives. Emma Ingalls was the founder with her husband of the Daily Interlake in Kalispell, and she was a newspaper woman at a time when women didn't do that kind of thing. It is said that she wielded a caustic pen. She wasn't afraid to criticize politicians and whoever. She also was the first person to irrigate in the Flathead Valley. Her husband was disabled, and she did all of the ranch work herself. The other woman, Maggie Hathaway, also was a character. She married a school administrator here in Helena, and he died 6 months later. So she was widowed very early. She had a ranch. She was from Ravalli County, and she had a ranch down there in the Bitterroot Valley. And she ran a manless ranch. She hired only women to work for her so that men could be free to join the armed forces during World War I. They called her Mrs. Has Her Way in the House of Representatives. And both of these women campaigned very hard for suffrage. It was a very weird time. It was a time when anti-German sentiment was very high. The German language was outlawed. We had here in Helena a very large German population, and a number of Germans spoke German in the home still. There was a German mass at that little Catholic church, St. Helena's Catholic Church, across from the House of the Good Shepherd, if you know where that is, on Hoback. That was the only German language mass that was said here in Helena. And of course, the German Lutheran Church that you see here, well, once World War I started and all these problems started, they dropped the word German from the name of the church. And of course, Montana had the most stringent sedition laws of any place in the nation. And Janet Smith was the only woman who actually went to Deer Lodge charged with sedition. She was convicted. 26 months later, after she had served part of her sentence, the verdict was overturned by the Supreme Court because they said that the language with which she was convicted wasn't strong enough to have rendered that verdict. So it was overturned and she got out. Her husband also was convicted of sedition. She supposedly said that the Red Cross was a fake organization, that all the cripples, the insane, and prisoners, which she became one herself, should be killed so that everybody else could have that food during the time of rationing. And she also said that if the country revolted against the president, she'd be the first one to shoulder a gun and get him. So that's why she was convicted of sedition, and that's why she went to Deer Lodge. It was also a time of fashion changes. The tube lipstick, in a metal tube, was invented in 1915. Cupid bows lips became popular. This poem appeared in the Independent Record that I'm going to read to you here during this time period when there was quite a lot of fashion statements going on and revolutions in clothing. Blessings on thee, little dame, bare-backed girl with knees the same, with thy rolled-down silken hose and thy short, transparent clothes, with thy red lips redder still, smeared with lipstick from the store, with thy makeup on thy face and thy bobbed hair's jaunty grace, from my heart I give thee joy, glad that I was born a boy. So this is the first time that women were able to buy rouge in a compact and compressed powder in a compact. And they even had a version of waterproof mascara, which is an advertisement for mascara. And of course, the bobbed hair was the thing. All the girls wanted their hair bobbed, and their mothers didn't want them to. And it was a really big deal. I remember my mother telling me that she was supposed to go to the beauty shop. My grandmother dropped her off, and she went instead next door to the barber shop, climbed in the chair. She was about 10 years old and climbed in the chair, and the guy said, "Well, what do you want?" And she said, "I have my money here. I want a windblown bob." And cut all her hair off, and she got in a lot of trouble. So anyway, bobbed hair was a really big deal. And the fashions, made for the first time younger girls look much older. Here you have high school girls who are dressed in the flapper outfits of the day. And they looked a lot older than girls did 5 years before they started wearing these types of clothing. And of course, men's clothing changed too. Looks like gangsters, doesn't it? And in the teens and into the 20s, women began to work outside the home. And this is kind of an interesting little story. The underwear had to be sort of reinvented to accommodate shorter skirts. And but some women still in the 20s, on the cusp of Prohibition and into the 20s, some women still wore corsets. And among the women that still wore corsets were the prostitutes. And Delia McGeever Sweeney, who was a corset fitter at Hennessy's in Anaconda, took training in Butte to learn how to do it. And most of her customers were ladies of the evening. And if she made a $50 sale, she got a $1 bonus. If she made a $100 sale, she got a $2 bonus. And that was a big deal back then. But her mother took her wages. And so these bonuses were separate, and her mother didn't know about them. And here's what she has to say about that. "Some days I would make $4, and I would put them down in my shoe so my mother wouldn't know. I wasn't going to give it to my mother because I figured I'd give them my wages when I come home, so I'm going to have that for me. Oh, my foot would hurt. I would put it down in my shoe because I wouldn't tell my mother where I was getting it, and it was all silver dollars, no paper money. I would have big round spots where I walked on the round dollars. I remember one time putting some of it under the kneeler in church because I was going to go to church the next morning. Oh, you'd pay your life to get a dollar, but big silver dollars down in your shoe, that's what I got. I thought a lot of times, should I tell that in confession? I didn't do nothing wrong, so I didn't." And then she wondered, too, if it was a sin to wait on these ladies. And then she decided she didn't think so she never confessed it. Helena, at the time of Prohibition, had 65 saloons. How did Helena handle this going dry? Like most other communities, on December 30th, 1918, saloons sold liquor for the very last time. And it was after that, it was actually, this is so bizarre, it was legal to possess liquor that you had bought before that time. How you could prove it, I mean, I don't know. But anyway, people did have private stashes. When Montana went dry, bars were mostly for men, as you can see here. Only the most disreputable women actually went to bars and drank in public places. Some places, especially in Butte, had wine rooms that were separate rooms for women. But generally, women didn't drink in public. And that was one big change after Prohibition, because all the women went to the speakeasies. It's a really big change, social change. So when Montana went dry, there were speakeasies everywhere. The word speakeasy comes from the idea that this was a place where you had to be quiet. You couldn't go to these establishments and make a lot of noise or be unruly because you'd get caught. And so that's where the term speakeasy comes from. In Butte, of course, there were lots of speakeasies. This one was discovered a couple of years ago in the basement of the Rookwood, if you know where that is. And if you take one of those Butte historical tours, I think they take you down there. It was found almost intact. That's what it looks like. I mean, they fixed it up and added tables and things, but look at the beautiful ceiling and the columns and that, and all that was still intact when it was discovered. In Helena, there were lots of speakeasies, but ones that I know about, there was one in the basement, or the basement level of the Placer, which later became the Cheerio Lounge. Probably some of you remember the Cheerio. I'm not sure what that time period is, probably after Prohibition, but anyway, it was a place where, you know, ladies went for luncheons and things. And also, Haps is the other place that I know about. And Haps was built in about 1920 as a restaurant by the Ibells. They later had a restaurant down on Main Street. A lot of people knew them. I can say that I have researched that establishment. And there's something weird about that, about the people who worked there, because they were all divorced. And there were men and women working as cooks and waiters. And I know for sure that there was always a back room where you could get moonshine. So Haps is one of those places that started out, you know, in a, I don't want to say disreputable way, but it kind of started out as a bar. It wasn't really supposed to be one, and it's always been one. Now, the definition of bootlegger, this is the definition here. Bootleggers carried flasks or bottles in their boots, and women did that too. And this woman has a flask in her stocking, probably in her garter. Yeah. And recipes for making moonshine were very easy to come by. Florence Smet's husband in Anaconda even had a still that was underneath the Lutheran church. I mean, people had stills everywhere. One woman said that if you walked the streets of Anaconda, you could smell the grapes fermenting everywhere. And the carloads by the boxcars, they would arrive, grapes would arrive at the depot, and nobody ever said anything. You know, it's obvious what that was for, but nobody ever caught them or made any mention of it or questioned those who picked up the grapes. So it does seem like everyone was involved in bootlegging and rum running in one way or another. And every brew tasted different, you know. Nothing was standardized or homogenized either, I guess you could say. And there was some really, really good moonshine, and there was some really, really, really bad moonshine. Harriet Malloy, you guys all knew her, probably told me one time, she was a high school and a college student during Prohibition, and she told me that it was very easy to find drinking parties, but you had to be really, really, really careful whose moonshine you drank, because you could go blind or you could die. Some of it was really bad. So you had to be very careful. And stills were everywhere, and this actually comes from, for those of you that have heard or will hear my talk on the Chinese, this is an interesting case in point, because this particular site at Poacher Gulch in Sanders County, everybody thought that this was a Chinese site, and they thought it was very old, going back to the 1880s, because this tree trunk had grown through the wheel. And that looks like, you know, it would be really, really old. Well, actually, this is what this is the artist's depiction of what that site looked like. And, you know, they found tar paper and nails and evidence of someone growing corn. And what it turned out to be was a place where they were growing corn for moonshine. And it had nothing to do with Chinese, and it turned out to be, you know, from the 1920s. So it's kind of an interesting thing. There were stills everywhere, and there still are, you know. You can come across those if you take hikes into the wilderness. And, of course, this government policy just profoundly failed. No government policy failed as stringently or profoundly as Prohibition did, and especially in Montana. First under that state law that was passed in 1918, and then under the Federal Volstead Act that was passed in 1919 and enacted in 1920. Nobody really realized that Prohibition would encourage illegal activities in the way that it did and foster the growth of organized crime, which it also did. Bootleggers were highly organized, and they were organized as a foil to the federal agents. And the bootleggers had their own lawyers. They had their own secret service force to look out for government spies, which were planted everywhere. And hoodwinking the revenue officer was often viewed as a game of cat and mouse. And there are lots and lots of tales of close calls and near misses in the histories, county histories of the 1920s. Good whiskey came across the border from Canada, and the back roads, a route from Coutts, Alberta to Great Falls, was later known as the Bootlegger Trail, but it went all the way to Denver, actually. Plenty of Montana moonshiners, though, brewed whiskey and wine and bathtub gin, and some of them were women. I heard it said that women in Helena marched religiously with the WCTU, and then they went home to cook their own brews and tend their own stills, which is probably true. Prohibition fostered organized crime, and that was true here, which we'll get to in a minute. But one of those female moonshiners was Josephine Duty, who lived in this remote cabin at the edge of Glacier Park. She was a woman who was probably even more notorious than Calamity Jane, and unlike Calamity, her past is for sure, we know for sure about her reputation and her life. Around 1890, she shot a guy in Colorado. She claimed it was in self-defense. She was awaiting trial and broke out of jail and fled to McCarthyville, Montana, which was a railroad town along the James J. Hill's Great Northern Railway route. And there, she became a dance hall girl and met Dan Duty, who fell madly in love with her. But she had this problem because she had an opium addiction. And so Dan planned how he was going to dry her out. And what he did was he kidnapped her and tied her to a mule and took her to his homestead up on the Flathead River that you just saw and locked her in there to dry out. You know, she was lucky, but she did survive and kicked the addiction, but then she took up moonshining. Now, her husband kept another tiny little cabin that was hidden, and this is where she went when the revenue officers came snooping around, or when the Colorado lawmen came looking for her, which they did periodically. She would go to this little cabin. Well, in their homestead, or outside their homestead, James Hill built a siding to her place, and the engineer would bring the train and blow the whistle once for every quart of moonshine that he wanted her to leave on the tracks for them. And Dan was one of the first rangers at Glacier Park, but unfortunately he liked to poach the game, and so he was fired. He died in 1919, but Josephine stayed in the two-story homestead, sort of keeping guest rooms, and she led occasional fishing parties. She died in 1936 after a very long and colorful life. Another woman was Bertie Brown, who you may have heard me talk about before in Fergus County. Bertie Brown is part of my African American program. She was an African American woman who homesteaded in 1911 to this place here. She had previously homesteaded in Montana in the 1890s and moved to this area. She was very, very famous for her moonshine. She supposedly made the best moonshine in the entire Northwest, maybe in the nation. It was really, really famous, and people came from everywhere to sample it and buy it. Unfortunately, in 1933, just at the very end, as Prohibition was approaching its end, the revenue officer visited her and told her, "Bertie, you better not. This had better be your last batch of brew, because if I come back and I find you brewing again, I'm going to take you to jail." And so, unfortunately, she was tending that batch. She also, as did a lot of the women back then, she took in cleaning, dry cleaning. And they would clean with gasoline, and they would clean the clothing, and then they would hang the clothing outside, you know, to dry out. And so she was doing that, and got too close to the still, and it exploded, and she was horribly burned. She lived about 24 hours, and you know, the last thing that she said to her friends who had gathered around her, "Please, please, please find my cat and take care of my cat." She had this wonderful black cat that she loved, and after she died, they never did find the cat. They looked and looked and looked, but people who drive by this place to this day, sometimes they will say there's often a black cat sitting in the window there. Another memorable character from Anaconda was Shoebox Annie. Some of you may have heard of her. She is one of the infamous female serial killers. If you get on the internet, there's a long list of female serial killers, which this website says has never been properly studied. So, but anyway, a lot of people in Anaconda recall her with mixed emotions. She lived in Goosetown in the 1920s, but she left such a great impression that even those kids growing up in the 1950s avoided the area of Alder and Commercial where her house once stood. There's nothing there now, and there was nothing there then in the 1950s, but the stigma was so great, kids just avoided that area altogether. So Shoebox Annie carried a shoebox around with her, out of which she sold soap and shoelaces and other items, including moonshine that she also carried in this box. She had a pet magpie that had a split tongue, and she would allow it had been taught to talk. I don't know what it said, but probably something that was rude. She sometimes went to the door with the door of the neighbors' houses with the magpie on her shoulder, selling stuff out of her her shoebox. Well, people would invite her in, and the magpie then would fly around to the bedroom and pick up jewelry off of the dressers and then fly home. And if you invited Annie into your house, she would steal things, and so would her magpie. And the only way to get rid of her was to buy her soap or something. So while some Goosetown kids frequented Annie's house, actually, others were definitely afraid of her. She and her son Skidmore, that's Skidmore there, supposedly killed people and buried them in her basement in her house in Anaconda. And sometimes these horrible, horrible, horrible smells would come from the house. Maybe it was her moonshine. Maybe it was something else. But the neighbors were convinced that she was boiling body parts. And there was some truth, actually, to the tales. Annie's real name was Mary Eleanor Smith. Authorities suspected her, actually, and her son of killing four people, including two who went missing while the pair lived in Anaconda during the 20s. Authorities believed that Annie and Skidmore dismembered the bodies in the bathtub and then burned the pieces and disintegrated them with acid. They did go to prison in Washington State for possessing items belonging to one of their victims. The son actually committed suicide in prison, so Annie stood trial by herself. But there wasn't any physical evidence, and so she was never actually convicted of murder. She's infamous, though, as one of the nation's very few female serial killers, supposedly. And here in Helena, probably some of you have heard my story about Reader's Alley and the canaries. Well, you know, that's a fairly famous ghost story that people have come to really like. And there was this woman, Laura Duchesne, in the 1920s. Actually, her residence in the Stone House, which is up there at the end of the alley, her residence there in that tiny apartment exactly coincides with Prohibition. 1918 to 1933, when she died, actually. But the interesting thing is that her livelihood she made by raising canaries in this little tiny apartment, and she raised hundreds and hundreds of canaries and advertised in the newspapers and in the city directories about her canaries. Maybe she sold them to the miners, you know, who did carry canaries. I don't know. But after the fact of this story, I had a student in one of my classes one time we were talking about Reader's Alley, and she told me that her grandfather told her that Reader's Alley was a known place to buy moonshine. At certain times of the month, Laura had this moonshine, and it's interesting because when they converted the Stone House to offices a couple of years ago, they had to wire the place for computers, and so they cut a section of flooring out in a square and lifted that out, and underneath there is a room. It had a homemade ladder going down into it, kind of carved out of the bedrock. It had a nice smooth floor, and was obviously used for something. And so this reporter asked me, well, what do you think it was for? That time I didn't really know anything, but I just sort of said, well, I bet it was used to store moonshine. I didn't know that she was a moonshiner. And so later, when this student told me, yeah, her grandfather said that Laura used to sell this moonshine, and people were terrified, you know, that the revenue officer was going to come around, because they would line up all the way back to Park Avenue. And so Laura would take her canaries out and line up all the cages all along the alley. And if anyone came and asked, if the revenue officer came and asked, what are you all doing here? They would just say, we're here to buy canaries. So canaries were actually the friend in that little... So another kind of bizarre outcome of Prohibition was the resurgence of the Ku Klux Klan. And it was active here in the Northwest and also active in Montana, where there were 40 different chapters and 5,000 members, including, well, I'll tell you this. This is another one of my favorite stories that sort of deals with that. It's not exactly a women's story, but just briefly, Einar Larson, some of you probably knew him, told me one time that he had a cousin, Melvin. Robinson Park, of course, was the Catholic cemetery, and Melvin was always told, you know, to stay away from the cemetery because those tombstones could fall over and it could be dangerous. So it was 1923 during Prohibition, and he was coming home late this one night, and he knew his mother was going to be really angry with him, and so he decided to cut through the cemetery, which is a much shorter way to get home. He knew he wasn't supposed to, but he's, you know, cutting through, and he gets to the edge over by Oak Street, and he sees these figures coming down the street toward him. And he ducks behind a tombstone and stuffs his knuckles in his mouth so he won't scream, because they're like white figures and they're wearing these flowing robes and the wind is kind of blowing, and he doesn't know what's going on, and he thinks that they're ghosts, and he sees them, and they make a right angle turn, and one by one all eight of them disappeared into the earth. So he hightails it home and bursts in his mother's kitchen, and his mother asks him, you know, what's going on, and he's blubbering about ghosts in the graveyard. And everybody made fun of him. But then the next morning, there was an article in the newspaper that said that the Ku Klux Klan had been in town to bestow a substantial donation on the Methodist Episcopal Church, which sat catty-corner across from the cemetery. And so if you look at the sandboard maps, you can see that there actually was a basement meeting room that went stairs going down. So all he had actually seen was the Klan, you know, attending this meeting. But there were many women's chapters of the Ku Klux Klan, and this one was some kind of a memorial presented by the women of the Klan in Billings. We don't know what it commemorated, but the stone still exists, which is kind of funny. And of course, in Helena, you know, the red light district, was a very lucrative business, and on the eve of Prohibition in 1917, houses of prostitution, cribs, parlor houses, all that sort of thing was closed by federal law because of the fear of spreading venereal disease to the troops during World War I. So, of course, the women didn't stop working in Butte. You know, they went underground. But these places along here were closed. And just to put it in context, this is Park Avenue. Let's see if I can get the cursor to show you. This is the caretaker's house right here. And this is the pioneer cabin. And all of these places are labeled female boarding, which is the euphemism in the Sanborn maps for prostitution. So we know for sure this was the rather lower class red light district. And the last place was the caretaker's house, which is what it looked like in 1903. That's the only picture I know of that we have of a Helena prostitute, actually. And anyway, that's what it looks like today. But those women were forced out of those places, and that area was closed. And also, this was the higher class district area. The blue is the Bluestone House, and the turquoise one is the castle. And I will be forever upset with Chet Huntley, who narrated that story of Helena in the 1960s before urban renewal, who identifies the Bluestone House as the castle, which it wasn't. But now it's confused in the public memory, and actually this is the Bluestone House, which overlooked the Red Light District, built by Lily McGraw, who was one of those three very wealthy proprietor madams. But her place of business was at the foot of the hill, and she lost her money and never finished the Bluestone House, and it was never lived in. But this is what the castle looked like. This was Molly Byrne's castle, and this was the really famous place that when you hear, you know, all of these wealthy men going to the Red Light District, the high class part, this was the high class house, and it was demolished in the 1960s. Anyhow, so the women were kicked out of those old areas that they had operated in from the 1880s up until 1917. And as in Butte, the women went underground and actually worked in underground cribs, like the miners. But in Helena, they didn't go underground. They actually resurfaced in rooming houses and the upper floors of business blocks like this. This is the Boston block and the St. Louis block where the windbag is, before urban renewal. Looks pretty seedy, doesn't it? So anyhow, in the upper floors of these two blocks, probably some of you are familiar with Ida Levy, who was the longtime madam there during Prohibition and after. And she kept a speakeasy at the back of what is now the Ghost Art Gallery frame shop. That's where her bar was. And it was a speakeasy, and later it was a bar, but she never had a license. She was always getting in trouble. She was constantly arrested during Prohibition for selling illegal booze, as were all of the women. She'd pay a fine and, you know, go back to doing it again. But she and other madams here in Helena also had gambling machines. They had one-armed bandits in their little speakeasies. And so the women were targeted at one point, and all of those gaming machines were confiscated. And they didn't know what to do with these machines because they were all full of money. And so they took them out to the city dump, and they took hatchets and broke them open and took the money and realized, I don't know, hundreds of dollars, and gave that money to the general fund for the school board, which I think is pretty funny. Anyway, Ida Levy began operating in the mid-1920s. And it's funny because one time I was in the library and I was standing there by the desk, and this very properly dressed woman and her daughter came in and were asking Brian Shovers, the librarian, if they would be able to find the bar that their great aunt had owned here in Helena. And so he said, well, yeah, we could probably look to see, you know, if we can find it in the city directories, and we can probably find it. You know, find out if it's still standing. And he said, so what did you say her name was? And they said, well, her name was Ida Levy. And he just about croaked. He didn't know what to say to her. And he blurted out, well, she was no bar owner. She was the best known madam in Montana. And these people from New York were just like, and actually, they were thrilled to discover their great aunt Ida's secret, because she had visited them in the summertime when they were kids, and she would take them shopping and buy them anything they wanted to buy. She was very wealthy, but of course they thought that she made her money, you know, attending bar. And she did, in fact, have the silver dollar bar, but that's not actually how she made her money. Anyway, you can see that she always wore these pins that were very gaudy, and people thought that they were costume jewelry, but actually they were the real thing. Yeah, and we know that she operated cribs during this time when cribs were supposed to have been outlawed. If you talk to Dave over at the Ghost Art Gallery, he'll tell you that when they carpeted the frame shop, they put carpeting over the wood floor, but you could see in the wood floor the grooves where those little cribs were. You know, cribs are the one-room offices that women worked out of, and they're very tiny little cubicles. Later, under The next madam, Dorothy, the whole upstairs was renovated and the cribs were taken out, and she actually made 5 proper bedrooms. But Ida Levy operated something else. And of course, this was her back door. That's what it looks like today, for those of you who, I'm sure everybody's familiar with that. And Big Dorothy's bathroom, of course, is preserved beautifully. Go in the frame shop and ask to see it, and they'll proudly show it to you. But this is what the area, the Bluestone House area, looked like before urban renewal in the 1950s, 1960s. And when women were periodically kicked out of the rooming houses during the 20s, they came back to these areas and operated in these horrible shacks that were in some cases put together with license plates and cardboard. And so the Independent Record in 1931 published a letter, and this person is talking about the impact Prohibition has had on the women of the Red Light District, and this is what it says. Every month sees a new series of outrages on the part of government agents. They love to frequent European hotels on South Main Street. These outcast women who sell their souls and now and then some drinks to make a miserable existence are the pet prey of Prohibition agents. They have been driven, as the district attorney has slapped abatement proceedings on the only homes that they know, they've been driven from them, from places once comfortable and as respectable for human beings to live in as they could be. These creatures have been driven by the Prohibition vultures and the district attorney into the oldest and most terrible old buildings in the city. Some of the places now occupied by these women are not fit for human beings to live in, but they are driven from sheer necessity and hunger to take up squalid quarters in tumble-down shacks, blocks, and cabins. They will sell or give away drinks again. They have no other way of making a living. Decent women and girls are out of jobs. What chance has a woman who has occupied these places and sold herself for years to secure employment? Following the next term of court, they will move into still worse places. If there are any in the city, if there are any in the city or its outskirts, the jungle, the tin can cabins made out of scraps and old building materials will be next. If some of them do not go, this is kind of hard to read, this is not very clear. Do not decide that 5 feet under the ground offers a safer and better place to go, a place where the government Cossacks do not persecute, a place where the brutal men do not seek to satisfy their lust, a place where their history will end abruptly. So pretty strong words. Okay, thank you. I'm almost done. So this is the St. Valentine's Day massacre that happened in 1929, just before, in the spring before the stock market crash. And Al Capone was responsible for killing 7 people in the opposing Bugsy Moran gang. So he lined them up against the wall and shot them. The massacre brought gangs to the forefront in the United States. People couldn't wait to read the headlines. And eventually it spelled the downfall of Al Capone. But on a local level, by spring of 1929, just before the big crash, national prohibition was 10 years old. Montana's prohibition was 11 years old. The most popular music was jazz. 1 in 5 owned a car. And long-held social taboos had definitely weakened. Lindbergh had flown across the Atlantic. Prohibition has been faulted for creating an era of hypocrisy and national naughtiness, which it did. But it also romanticized lawlessness and the bootleggers and the gangsters who provided illegal liquor and other vices to respectable citizens. So in 1929, Al Capone and Bugsy Moran made national news, but Montana had gangs too. And in June of 1929, there was a series of bank robberies and beatings and kidnappings, and it sort of read like a soap opera. It was very melodramatic. The newspaper, left people hanging on every word and waiting for the next installment. And during these robberies and beatings and abductions and stuff, the criminals drove these fast cars, and piecing all the clues together, they were all rounded up and tried, except for one, by the fall. But associated with this gang was a woman, and she was known as the woman in white, who was sometimes used as a decoy in these robberies. And by fall, she was on trial and actually was acquitted of any wrongdoing, because she said she was under the influence of drugs and alcohol, and she was, you know, at the beck and call of these gang members. So she was exonerated of any wrongdoing. But she probably knew things that she shouldn't have known. And so less than 2 months later, Bobby Kelly, who with Gene Mills were operating a prostitution business in the upper floors of the novelty block, were shot. Somebody came in and killed Bobby Kelly and shot Gene Mills in the face. And she survived, though. And eventually, this is where they were working, in the upper floors of the novelty block. And eventually, Nick Janku was arrested. And he had been convicted of bootlegging. It was a very dramatic trial. All the women were in love with Nick Janku. He wore these very flashy clothes. He was very, very handsome. Women would swoon in the courtroom. The courtrooms were packed. And they would cheer when he testified and stuff. Lester Lobel was the defense attorney. And Gene Mills testified, and that was very dramatic. She had recovered enough to be able to testify. In the end, he was acquitted, and they never did find who committed that murder. But several years later, there was another body that was found out in the South Hills. Obviously, it was someone who knew too much. So we'll never know really what happened. Of course, the cupola of the novelty block is on the top of that kiosk on the walking mall, and that's the only remnant left. Well, Bishop Finnegan said to 5,000 Catholics that we're less temperate because we have passed from self-regulation under God to a form of civic regulation, and that there is more drunkenness in America than there was before Prohibition. And so by 1931, things were clearly out of hand. But Prohibition did die a public death in 1933. President Roosevelt knew that it would, that the repeal would take time, so he made 3-2 alcohol legal in Walker's Bar that you see here. Notice it's all men. In Walker's Bar, the very next day after he signed the Cullen Harrison Act on April 7th, on April 8th, they're celebrating with 3-2 beer in Walker's Bar. Well, they claim to have been the only bar in the nation that had 3-2 beer. Where they got it, I don't know. But supposedly, there were 1.5 million kegs of beer that were consumed that day. So they couldn't have been the only ones. Anyway, the question is, where did they get it on a moment's notice like that? Because the first shipment of Pabst didn't arrive until 5 days later. So I don't know. Anyway, while Walker's served men only, men weren't the only ones celebrating. And men and women have lived happily and more ever since. And that concludes my... Questions? No questions, no comments.